great to have you, especially on a big news day, because you bring perspective. What does the president-elect Joe Biden and then Joe Biden administration actually mean for the world economy?
Well, I think, first of all, it means re-engaging from the United States, re-emphasizing international cooperation to the many challenges we face globally. So that's good news. I think that's the first reaction that you see in the market today. Initially, at least, I would expect that we see a sort of reinforcement of the existing trend that we've seen in the market for a while, hunt for yield and grow stocks. We will see then how things play out. Obviously, much depends on whether he has a united government or a divided government. We won't know, most likely, until January 5th. So there are open questions. But the initial impulse is certainly for the world to look forward to a United States that re-engages in a more systematic, more predictable way to tackle many of the severe problems we face globally.
If you look at some of the pledges that, you know, Joe Biden has put in place, Philipp, what is his number one priority? What should it be? Is it dealing with COVID? But is there a danger that actually then that changes the trajectory of the U.S. economy?
You know, one of the things I did this weekend, I went back to his initial speech when he launched a campaign. And what's quite remarkable, I think, about this campaign, in a way, it's perhaps unique in the history of campaigning, is just how consistent his message has been. He really has not changed. The soul of the nation was there at the very beginning. It was there at the very end of the acceptance speech yesterday. Climate change has been there at the very beginning. It's there today. Reinvigorating infrastructure, the nation is there in the beginning. It's there at the very end. So my position is we should take him by his word. He's going to attempt to do exactly what he's been saying in a very consistent way from the very beginning. Clearly, the first priority has to be to fight this growing pandemic. Let's not forget it is growing. You said it a minute ago, more than 100,000 cases a day. And that's clearly what he set out to do first. I would expect that we will see a coherent plan around climate change and, frankly, around infrastructure spending. That might get more difficult if there is a divided government. So we know that the market will have to deal with that. But I do think that the remarkable thing about this campaign and this victory is the consistency of the message from the very beginning right up to the acceptance speech last night.
Dr. Hildebrand, Tom Keenan here. Good morning to you. I want to go back to your public service to Switzerland and the Swiss National Bank. We're seeing dollar weakness. Most of the people today don't understand true dollar weakness off of Plaza and Louvre in the 1980s. How much dollar weakness can the president-elect stand? How much dollar weakness can Europe or China stand?
Look, I would say if you look at the overall challenge that President-elect Biden faces with his new government, it's pretty fair to say this is really difficult, right? I would argue that this is probably one of the most complex and urgent set of problems that any incoming president has faced in American history. What he doesn't have right now, which is a difference to 2008, is you don't have the market sort of breathing down your neck. There isn't an imminent problem in financial markets. But just about on every other level, he is facing a very, very complex set of challenges, and we need to be realistic about how difficult this will be. And of course, one of the elements of this, Tom, is a very high debt level. You know, we're now looking right at a huge debt level. So at some point, that becomes a constraining factor. I don't think that's imminent. I think he does have fiscal space. Whether he can use it politically, that's a different question. We won't have clarity in that until January. But I think certainly fiscal policy will continue to play an important role. And I think he does have leeway and can use that card and should use that card, notwithstanding some of the concerns around the dollar.
Let us recalibrate here on the percent of GDP that we're going to need in fiscal aid. Since we've talked to you, Philipp, we've seen real deterioration in lockdowns of the United Kingdom and the continent. And, of course, we're looking at the United States as well. Do we completely misjudge a 2 or 3% income substitution out of fiscal, or are we really going to be looking at 6 or, dare I say, 7% of GDP as the fiscal aid necessary?
I think so far the fiscal piece in conjunction with the monetary piece, let's not forget that, has been able to make up much of the income loss in a sense that we've seen. More is now required. Initially, my sense would be that he will probably be quite successful in activating a significant fiscal response to COVID itself, right? This is a growing pandemic. Everybody in the United States has an interest to tackle this. We do have quite good information on what you can do, looking at other countries' experience over the last year or so, including some of the most successful countries in Asia. I think that the challenge here will be, can he activate the full force of the U.S. government through fiscal policy to tackle some of the longer structural issues around labor market scarring, transforming the economy? And that remains an open question, and I think will depend greatly on where these outstanding Senate seats go ultimately in January.